Okay, Kevin, we are starting. All right, the last time, Kevin, we discussed the rate equation from Einstein, and we mentioned that we have three light-matter interactions, which has to do with the absorption, spontaneous emission, and stimulated emission. And we have seen that the two procedures, like absorption and stimulated emission, they need an external triggering in order to be initiated and to start, let's say. And what we would like in lasers, we would like to discover these conditions that will make the stimulated emission the dominant process. This is like some formulas that they allow us to calculate very fast the energy, each frequency, each photon with a wavelength lambda 2/1 can carry, which is very important because this describes the energy a monochromatic light has. And we have highlighted that the energy of an electromagnetic wave is quantized, and it comes as the integer multiple of this minimum energy packet, which is related, which relates with the energy of a photon. So the stimulated emission is the process that we want, and the main characteristics of the stimulated emission is the emission of two similar photons or similar photons, which means, speaking with the electromagnetic wave terminology, that they have the phase in space and in time, and also the same direction. In order the stimulated emission to be the dominant process, we should break the thermal equilibrium. And in this transparency, we describe what is valid under thermal equilibrium. And we can see that the majority of the population, the majority of the atoms populates the lower energy levels than the higher ones. And one of the conditions in order to establish stimulated emission is like to build, as we will see later on, or we have already seen, a population inversion. So we should break this thermal equilibrium, we should pump our system, and this will be the topic of the today's course, in order to populate heavier the higher energy levels than the lower ones, and at the end of the day, to build the population inversion among two discrete energy levels. The upper energy level is called the upper laser energy level, whereas the lower one is called the lower laser energy level. So we need an external pumping process in order to achieve this. Let me go because the system lagged. And here we can see, if we build population inversion, as you can see within the circle, we have the dominance of the stimulated emission. The emitted laser light, of course, is the most monochromatic light, is not a monochromatic light. And we have seen, and we will discuss later on, the detailed mechanisms that drive to this broadening. We are moving a little bit away from a discrete line around the central frequency, and we have something like a Gaussian, a curve with which is, it has a width, and this width describes the monochromaticity of the emitted light. One mechanism that always appears and always contributes to the broadening of our emission light or the absorption light, it has to do with the natural broadening and has to do with the lifetime of an electron on the excited state. We also presented, we analyzed a little bit more what are these parameters that they generate and produce the gain. Remember, laser light, light amplification. And we have seen using this Birch-Lambert's law, and Birch and Lambert were two German chemists. And we have seen that the gain over there, this gain factor, it has to do with the population inversion, how strong population inversion we have achieved, multiplied by this cross-section factor. And this cross-section factor is related with the probability for the transition to happen. And this transition, it relates from the lower to the upper energy level and from the upper to the lower one. So in order to move from the absorption coefficient to move to a gain coefficient, what we should achieve is population inversion. And if we achieve population inversion, then our system amplifies light and can lead to the emission of laser light. So Einstein described this all these processes using some differential equations. And we have seen the first one. It has to do with the spontaneous emission. And T2 is the lifetime of the electrons or the atoms on the excited state. And this T2, 1 over T2 is the broadening regarding frequencies. So this is the natural broadening. So the natural broadening is mainly described by this time, T2. And also one other important figure from this graph is that the spontaneous emission Einstein coefficient, AT1, is the reverse of the lifetime of the electrons on the upper energy state. And this is something that we can measure. And since we can relate this Einstein coefficient with the other two Einstein coefficients for absorption and simulate emission, is something that we can measure, so we can calculate any Einstein coefficient. So this is like what we describe as spontaneous emission. We excite, and if we leave the system by itself, it will relax back to its thermal equilibrium. And the time that it takes to relax, is related with the time of the atoms on the upper excited state. This giga excitation is not only has to do with the photonic processes, but also has to do with non-photonic processes, non-radiated processes, that has to do with the temperature of the system and its nature. Then we moved on to stimulated emission. And again, we can see the impact of the external field with the parameter rho ni, which describes the energy over frequencies over the volume that we pump the material or illuminate the material. So rho ni is the electromagnetic wave that interacts with our system under population inversion. This is something that is desirable and induces this stimulated emissions. This is the rate equation for absorption. That's why we have a minus ni one. And again, we need the external parameter in order to induce the absorption. Without some appropriate photons to illuminate and interact with our system, we cannot achieve absorption, which means to excite our population. If we try to calculate the total downward rate, which means from the upper to the lower energy state, this downward rate has to do with the spontaneous emission and the stimulated emission, then we have a total rate R21, all right? So in order to study and find out what are the conditions for lasing, we study our system under thermal equilibrium. And under thermal equilibrium, this rate, this downward rate, equals to the upward rate. And the upward rate has to do with the absorption. So if we study our system under thermal equilibrium for the two, which means that the two populations, due to the emissions or due to the absorptions, they don't change, then we can solve the presented Einstein equations. We find out, we reach this kind, and we solve for the spectral energy density, we reach this formula. Since our system is under thermal equilibrium, we know from quantum mechanics that any system under thermal equilibrium, which means that absorbs and emits at the same rate, can be simulated with the black body radiation. And we know from the quantum mechanics that a black body radiation is characterized by energy density that can be seen on the bottom of this transparency. So if we looked at the first formula, the top formula with the bottom one, the first parts are equal, so the second ones. So if we make the equation and take into account that we are under thermal equilibrium, which means that we have the majority of the population atoms on the lower energy states, not on the excited one, then we can reach these results. And these results show to us, they compare the three processes. So the first formula compares the spontaneous process divided by the stimulated emission, and the lower one compares the absorption with the stimulated emission. G1 and G2, we have mentioned that are called the degeneracies, where the degeneracies, they describe the number of energy states with energy E1 and energy E2, respectively. What we can see and what we can conclude is, like, from the first formula, we can say that the spontaneous emission over stimulated emission depends on the frequency, and the higher the frequency, the stronger the effect of the spontaneous emission over stimulated emission, which means that if we would like to make the stimulated emission stronger than the spontaneous one, we should go to a lower frequencies, which means to the higher wavelengths. And this is the reason why the first lasers, they were red lasers, where the wavelength is like 685 nanometers, where the blue lasers are something like 400. You can see, so it was easier for the infrared lasers to be fabricated, since for lower frequencies or otherwise higher wavelengths, the stimulated emission is stronger than spontaneous emission. Also, the other example and the other conclusion that we reached by looking the first formula is, like, we can move to higher temperatures. The higher the temperatures, of the stronger the effect of stimulated emission. But of course, we should take into account that for crystals, we have the melting frequency, temperature, and also by increasing the temperature, we increase the oscillation of the crystals, and these oscillations can knock down some of our population inversion to the lower one through non-radiative situations. So there is an upper limit how high temperature you can have your system. Usually, any system, in order to be efficient, energy efficient, we should operate it at room temperature. On the second formula, and for simplicity, if we consider G1 and G2 parameters equal to 1, we can see B12 equals to B21, and this generates the result that absorption and stimulated emission, they have the equal probability to happen if we have the same population. So the second formula says to us, in order to make stimulated emission stronger than absorption, you need to have more population on the upper energy state than to the lower one. So you need to pump your system. And this is like a short review of what did we say the last time. Let me now go to the next set of the transparencies. Any questions at this point?
No question.
You have a question?
No, no question.
No question. Okay, no question. No question. Let me now find, because I cannot see where I have the file. Oh my God. Yeah. Let me share my screen. Okay, so now we need to somehow give some information about the pumping, and we need the pumping. Can you tell me, David, Kevin, why do we need the pumping?
Because we must, the stimulated emission must be higher than the absorption.
Exactly, and this can happen only by pumping, okay? So what is pumping? Pumping is an external energy source. The same situation we have for the electrical amplifiers. So for example, if you think an operational amplifier, you need the external power source in order to for your signal to be amplified in a such a configuration. The same with the optical amplifiers, which are the lasers. So you can consider the operational amplifiers as a similar electrical system with lasers. So if you think about inverted or non-inverted configuration of operational amplifier, is the same to think a laser in the optical field. So we need something in order to prepare our system and generate gain for some incoming radiation that can interact with our material. And this usually is the light that is emitted from the spontaneous emission, and this electromagnetic wave interacts with our system, and we have the spontaneous the stimulated emission, and thus the gain. So let's see how we can pump a system, and a part of the system that we can pump, we're going to introduce the term of the optical isolator, of optical oscillator, the cavity. Remember that the three essential building blocks of a laser is the medium. We should prepare our medium in order to provide gain, and this can be done by pumping. And also we need the oscillator. And why do we need the oscillator? We need the oscillator because we have to generate gain more than the losses. And this can be done in the practical way by trapping our gain medium, which means that we have built the population inversion within a pair. This is the simplest configuration, a pair of high reflected mirrors. This means that the emitted electromagnetic wave, since it's directional, and if we align our mirrors in order to support a specific direction, which should be this one of the emission, we pass these photons from an area that we introduce gain. So our photons, they are trapped within this direction, and whenever they pass through a gain medium, they are amplified even more and even more and even more in order to have this laser light. Usually before, when we press the button and the light emits, we have done more than, of course, this depends on the gain coefficient of our material. We have, before the laser light emits, we have more than a thousand oscillations within the cavity before laser appears. So the cavity fundamentally and prolongs, all right, the length of our gain medium. So a crystal could be a few millimeters, but by entrapping the light within an oscillator, within the pair of these two high reflected mirrors, we pass the light through our material several times. So it is like we have kilometers of this crystal, and our light amplifies as propagates through this crystal because of the population inversion. So these are the things that I'm going to skip since we have seen, and then let's see the pumping things. So how we can pump a laser? Have you ever an idea? Have you ever seen a laser? You tell me that we can pump it with this way or the other way. Any idea, Kevin?
If we apply electrical voltage.
Exactly, and this is the case. And this is the case, Kevin, of the electrical pumped lasers. And we have such a systems as the diode lasers. The diode laser, the small one, one of the smallest laser configurations are pumped electrically. Okay, very well. Any other example?
If we use a coil for the magnetic
If we use what?
Coils, or if we want to manipulate the magnetic field.
In the lasers, we are using magnetic fields in lasers in order to induce some, to reveal some extra energy levels within the our gain medium. But the magnetic fields, they have nothing to do with the pumping. Of course, if you apply a magnetic field along a material and you induce these extra energy levels, of course, this energy level, this energy difference between these energy levels that appears dictates some different wavelengths that we should pump our material, but let's not relate it. Let's not relate magnetic fields with pumping. We can pump a laser system with another laser, which is an optical pumping, all right? So photons that emit from another laser system can interact with the system that we would like to pump, and this is the optical pumping. Usually, the solid state lasers, like neodymium, yag, titanium, sapphire, or organic lasers, they are pumped by other laser systems. We can provide this external energy to our system by an exothermal chemical reaction, so chemically pump the system, and also we can induce an electrical discharge in order to pump our system. So we can have four ways, mainly four ways: electrical pumping, optical pumping, electrical discharge, and chemical pumping. All right, and let's see and which method we are using is mainly determined by the laser system that we have. I gave you some examples that the diode lasers mainly are pumped electrical current. Solid state lasers mainly used optical pumping, other lasers, dye lasers, etc., and organic lasers. We use again optical pumping. So what we would like to achieve with the pumping is like to achieve this population inversion. And we should think the following, that the gain coefficient, so how strong we are going to amplify our light through stimulated emission is mainly determined by the pair of the energy levels that we are going to pick up as an upper and lower energy levels. And this determines the population for this transition to happen. The how heavy population inversion we can achieve, and also from the length of our medium. So each one of these energy levels, they have a cross section. Usually a good cross section for the systems that we are using is something like 10 minus 21. Centimeter squared, from 10 minus 18 to 10 minus 21, 24, I think is the values that we experience. So in order to increase the amplification of the circulated light, we should increase the length of the crystal, we should increase and maximize the population inversion. And if I go back, there are some limitations. For example, if we are discussing about crystals, solid-state lasers are mainly crystals, we cannot fabricate crystals more than a few, I would say, centimeters. It's very hard to temperature control longer crystals, and also longer crystals, with the fabrication of longer crystals, we increase the probability of defects within the crystals, and the defects, they generate trap states within our energy band gap, and this will increase the threshold, the minimum population inversion we should achieve in order to have a laser. So if we would like to go for, and we want to go for lengths more than a few centimeters, what we are doing, we trap the crystal within a pair of high reflectors, and by this way, it's like artificially increase this length for more than a few millimeters, and can have, you know, depending on the number of the oscillations within the cavity, even kilometers. And also we should achieve the maximum population inversion. The maximum population inversion mainly is determined by the lifetime that we can keep our electrons on the upper energy state, and also of the lifetime of the lower energy level, because this dictates how fast the lower energy level gets empty in order to have continuously population inversion. So if you imagine two energy levels, and the upper one have a very long lifetime, then we can keep and we can provide time to our system to excite as many atoms on the on this level. And at the same time, if the lower energy state has a very short lifetime, this means whenever we have the excitation, the electron on the lower energy level will always be vacant, since it has a tendency to move away. Any population can reside on it. Okay?
Okay.
So there are limitations. I mentioned about the length. I comment about the achieve population inversion. Let's move on. These are the types that we are using: an optical source, an electrical discharge, an exothermic chemical reaction. Here are some systems. This is a titanium sapphire laser, and you can see that the laser system is here, and we pump it with this Verdi laser. This is a another laser system that pumps through these tubes our customized laser system, and we have we can see the lasing. So in order to achieve lasing, and here somewhere here is a crystal I can see, we have to pump it with another laser. These are a table that describes different laser systems and the different type of lasers, and you can see that a laser system, if we start with this is a gas laser, these are two gas lasers, you can see. So usually the gas lasers, they are we are using the electrical discharge technique. Laser diodes, we are using electrical pumping. And the other solid-state laser, like neodymium yang and titanium sapphire, we use optical pumping. Copper vapor is another gas, we use electrical discharge. And dye laser systems, which is a liquid type of laser, we are using optical pumping. So you can see, you can relate that the pumping, what kind of the format of the external pumping source is mainly determined by the type of lasers that we have. All right, so we need to calculate some of the parameters in order to define the gain that we have achieved, or the gain that if we, or if we would like to calculate the threshold, the threshold level of our system, which is the minimum gain that we should have in order to have laser light, and we should calculate some parameters, and these parameters are the population density of the involved energy levels, the excitation rate, the how fast we excite our system, and the lifetime of the electrons or the atoms on the excited state. So if this excited, the lifetime of the atoms on the excited state is short, we should pump with a high excitation rate. If this is long, probably we should reduce the demands that we have regarding excitation. Also, the excitation rate has to do also with the de-excitation rate. So if we would like to build population inversion, I will say that this excitation rate should be higher than the de-excitation rate. Okay, so to excite more atoms than these atoms are de-excited. So if we would like, this is a formula that describes the number of the atoms per volume of the atoms on the upper energy state. That's why we have this indices upper compared to the lower one. So this figure over there is determined by how many population we have on the lower energy state with the rate at which we pump this lower population to the higher one, and of course on the time that this excited atoms stay on the upper energy state. So these are the parameters. And usually in order to have in the systems that we are using and for the lengths of a system that we have for the most typical cross-section population, the most typical cross sections that we have in the system. This is the gain that we usually experience, 12 plus minus 5, all right? So if you achieve a gain of this order and above, then you have high probabilities to get a gain, all right? And this is how this formula can be related with the reflectivities. These are the reflectivities of the two mirrors, all right? So this is the value that we have without a cavity, and this is like something like the value that we can have if we trap our gain medium within a pair of two mirrors. There are two kinds of pumping that we can achieve. The direct one has to do, the pumping energy comes here, it is absorbed and interacts with our material, and we excite, we build population inversion between the upper and the lower one, and then we have the stimulated emission and the emission. This is a direct one. Here, we can see on this figure the second architecture or the second setup, which is pump and transfer. So we pump. This is the case of the helium neon. You can see that you have two atoms, helium and neon. All right, so you exploit the absorption of the helium, you pump helium, you excite helium, and the helium energy then is transferred to the excited state of neon. Then you have the excitation of the excited neon atoms to a lower excited energy level, and you build population inversion between this state and this state. Both of them are excited energy levels, since the ground state is here, which means that theoretically both of them are empty. So by transferring just one electron, you build population inversion between 3s2 and 2p4. This notation is something that probably we will do later on. It has to do with quantum mechanics and the orbitals that the electrons they have on this excited state, but forget about this for the moment. Kevin, do you have any background in quantum physics?
No background. As you should write, the orbitals, I have just a lecture with a doctor in another course with Dr. Kagatsu. Learn about a little about orbitals.
With Kayakatsos?
Kayakatsu, yes.
Okay. So here we have the pump and transfer. And we can see more things about pump and transfer. The intermediate Q level is much closer to the upper energy level than the initial ground state. And the stored energy in level Q is transferred to the level U. It's like you can see that we pump this pair, then we transfer, and the most usual transfer is the third one from the upper to the lower. This is hardest to achieve because you need another energy. This is something that can happen, but with a lower probability than this one, since the tendency of the nature is to move from the upper to the lower one. So in the case of helium neon, this is the case that we have. We pump helium, and then the helium atoms, they transfer, the excited helium atoms, they transfer their energy to neon, and then we have the excitation of the neon atoms, and then we have the building of population inversion between upper and lower within the collection of the neon atoms, and we have the laser. It is important that the pumping to happen within the spectral region, the material absorbs maximum. This means that we pump our system with wavelengths that belong and are under the absorption spectrum of this material. The electrical or the electrical discharge pumping efficiency is mainly determined by the velocity of the particles that we accelerate. This is the electrical discharge. You have a potential difference, and you accelerate electrons. These electrons they kick the atoms of our material, and through this kick they transfer momentum, which means kinetic energy, from the accelerated electrons to our atoms. We excite them and we build population inversion. And a part of the absorption spectrum of the material, its architecture, the material's architecture, also affects the pumping efficiency. We are saying this because we have this cross section. Now, wow, let me ask you, how many energy levels do you think that they are involved within a lasing process? So if I will ask you, how many energy levels do you need in order to achieve lasing, how many you will say to me?
At least three.
At least three. Why? May I ask you why you did not say to me two?
Because with two we can have a population inversion.
How did you reach this result? And how did you think about this? This is correct, but how did you think about this?
I read on a book.
Wow, you are reading by yourself.
No, another book, Principles of Lasers, a book of the bibliography that you have mentioned.
Wow. Oh, very good, thank you very much. As I told you, you are the best Erasmus student that I have ever had. All right, yes, with two, it's true. We cannot achieve population inversion. The maximum condition that we can reach is like the population to become equal. And when the population becomes equal, then the incoming and the outgoing laser beams, their intensity is the same. So the system does not interact, the oscillating wave does not interact, does not amplify, or does not de-amplifies the circulated electromagnetic wave. So we used to say in this case that the material is transparent, okay? Because the electromagnetic wave that passes through it is not amplified, but also is not lower. Then you are very right, as we will see, and this was the case of the first laser system, we need at least three energy levels in order to have a laser. And this was the case with the first laser system, the Ruby one. But the problem with the three energy level is that its efficiency. You should pump at least the half of the population of the ground state to the excited states in order to build this population inversion. So by pumping, it's like you have a class A linear amplifier that you need to place the cue point between the saturation and the cutoff points before you add your electrical oscillation. So you have spent a lot of energy in order to prepare your system. The same with the three laser systems, you should spend a lot of energy to prepare your system to have a gain before the system starts to lase. The most appropriate ones and the most common ones right now are the four active medium systems, which means that they involve at least four energy levels with specific characteristics, as we will see, before we have the emission. So let's see with two. These are two energy level systems. When we have two energy laser systems, this means that one of them is the ground state. So the maximum thing that we can achieve is like to pump the half of the population of the fundamental of the ground states to the excited ones. When you know this one, when these two populations they become equal, then the beam that interacts with such a system, it passes the system without interaction. So you don't have absorption, you don't have stimulated emission, since the probability, since these two factors, remember, the Einstein for absorption and the Einstein coefficient for simulated emission are equal. So with equal populations, this rate of absorption and stimulated emission are equal, so nothing happens. Okay, so if we move, we need at least three energy levels. And if we play around, it's something that I should describe to you before these results. Let me do it the way. So these are the two ones. We need population inversion in order to have a gain. So with such a system, we cannot achieve population inversion. And we move to the three ones. The three ones, they involve the ground state, which is one, and the two excited states, three and two. So what we are doing, we pump our system with an electromagnetic wave that encourages, is related, which means it relates with the energy band gap between three and one. All right, so we pumped our system like this. Our excited population stays on an excited level three, and then the lifetime of the electrons on this excited state should be short in order very fast these excited atoms to transit to excited energy level two. And with this, we manage to build population inversion between two and one. Someone will tell to me, oh, wow, this is the case that we had before, the population inversion between an excited state and a fundamental one. No, it's not the same, because here the emission light is different than the pump light, all right? So in order to induce stimulated emission, then through spontaneous emission between two, one, we generate this electron, this photon that interacts with this material, and this wavelength is much different than the pumping. In comparison within this case, that the pumping, the emission is the same with the pumping, all right? So it's not the case that we reach this lock point that our system becomes transparent. But what is the problem? In order to achieve population inversion between two and one, this is the ground state, which means it's the collection of the energy states that according to the quantum mechanics have been populated with atoms. And this means that we should excite at least the half of this population to number three and thus to number two in order to build population inversion from two to one. So we need to pump a lot our system, and this degrades or lowers the efficiency of the system. So this is the problem. As you can see, that the population inversion that we should achieve should be higher than the half of the population of the fundamental state. This is the minimum rate at which we can pump our system. And you can see that in order to excite this population to the upper energy level, the rate should be at least equal to the lifetime of all this population to this excited state. So if we would like to lower, make more attractive our system, if this T2, which is the time that the electrons, they can stay on the excited state, is a long time, this rate goes lower, and this makes our system more attractive. So one key point in order to, a message to keep is like, we would like the electrons to stay for long, long periods with the on the excited state than on the, in order to give time for population inversion building to happen, all right? So since the efficiency of the three energy level system is lowered by using a three-level laser system. We move to the fourth energy level. And by moving to the fourth energy level, we include here, we contain here, as you can see, we contain the ground state and three other excited states. And what we would like to do is to build population inversion between two excited states. This is very attractive, since we know that the excited states are less populated than the ground states. This is something that we know from the nature, which means that fundamentally, if we brought here one electron on this state, we can build population inversion because one should be empty, right? So the thing, so the how hard we can pump this stuff, we can pump it by providing, by exciting to number to energy level two, the minimum population inversion that we need. And also this this rate also is related not by just this number, but also by the lifetime of the electrons on this excited state. All right, so the idea is like to make this number as low as possible, which this is related with the threshold point of our system. The less the less the demands we have from our pumping source, the more attractive system we have. All right, ideally, this will be two, all right, because the population difference here, now this can be one, because with one electron, we can build population inversion, but also we like the lifetime of the electrons on the upper laser energies, on the upper laser energy level to be as long as possible in order to reduce the threshold. And also to give time to our system to build this population. I mentioned the word threshold. So I would like you to comment with me because I think now I spoke too much for this lecture compared to my habits to ask a lot of questions. So I followed your instruction. I just spoke myself. I would like to ask you, what is threshold? You can think of this definition by thinking of the electronics.
We cannot... There is a maximum, and this maximum cannot...
The threshold has to do with the maximum or with the minimum? So the threshold, in a system, we don't have only gain, we have also losses. And the losses can happen because of defects within the crystal of our gain medium. And these losses, they can hinder population that we try to populate on a specific energy level to energy levels because of the defects that exist within the energy within the energy band gap or within within the energy band gap of the two levels that we would like to obtain population inversion. Also, probably we have reabsorption. So we have the emission of a light that absorbs by our material and is trapped. And so we prohibit this oscillation within the crystal in order to enhance the pumping level. So these are called the interabsorption processes, scattering by imperfections. So we can have like bigger atoms that they can scatter our electromagnetic wave. And also if we have the mirrors, if we include the mirrors in order to build the oscillator later on, the escape light can be useful for us, but also it's a loss of our system. So we have losses. And in order to have a gain, you should make the gain higher than the losses. All right, when the gain equals to the losses, this is the threshold. So the losses, they define the minimum pumping energy you need in order to achieve lasing. So the lower the losses, the more attractive your system, the higher the losses, the higher the threshold, the less attractive is the system, okay? So let's go the last part of today's lecture, the optical resonator. So we need the optical resonator in order to, as we have the technical limitation and the operational limitation to build very long crystals. We need to build high quality crystals with less defects in order to minimize the losses. But if you make the crystal short, this means by thinking the Beers-Lambert's law that you have shortened the length of the gain area of the gain. So this is something that you don't want. You would like your beam to be amplified as much as possible, and this only can be done if my beam has generated. And this is a very directional light within the crystal because we have lasing, and we would like this lasing beam to propagate before the output, to propagate through a region that we have high gain. The longer this region, the higher the output we will get. All right. Since we cannot build such a long crystals, we can trap them within the cavity mirrors, and we make the passing, we increase the passing through this gain area by the number of oscillations that we can have. Of course, this pair of mirrors should be stable. What does it mean, stable mirror? It should have these mirror cavities. They should have a length that satisfies the standing condition, which means that after, when we have an electromagnetic wave, if an electromagnetic wave, we would like an electromagnetic wave to get amplified, we would like after one round trip, the phase difference to be 2 pi or to be zero. We know that if we add two electrical signals that they demonstrate a phase difference zero, or they demonstrate a phase difference of 2 pi, you know, then we have constructive interference. On the other case, if the length of the distance between our cavity mirrors is corresponds to a phase difference after one round trip of 180 degrees, this means that our oscillating beam will cease after a few circles, since we introduce a destructive interference, all right? So in order to design our cavity, our oscillator, with the purpose to increase our gain by increasing the length of the area, the length of the pathway where our beam can be enhanced because of the stimulated emission, we should take care also of this distance, which should be such that this constructive interference is supported. So let's see, this is a laser beam that is circulated within a cavity where L is the length of our crystal. We have assumed that we have built population inversion within this crystal. And this means that if we have a stable cavity, this is the first electromagnetic wave as it appears. And after one round trip, we are here. So another wave starts. And in order these two waves, the final one with the initial one, if they demonstrate here 180 degrees, my field will cease. But if this phase difference is zero, then we have an amplification. All right? So this length is very crucial. This is the gain that my system introduced within a cavity. So we have the crystal that is end faces. They have been polished and operate like high reflective mirrors for the wavelength that this system supports. And after one round trip, this is the gain that we experience. R1, R2 are the reflection coefficients of these mirrors. So R1 non-capital equals to the amplitude of R1 squared. So we have R1, R2 exponential, because remember the exponential comes from the Beer's law, 2 times 2L, because we have one round trip. So we have L plus L. Okay, so and K are the gain, which is related, this gain here, this gain coefficient is related with the population inversion, and also it's very much related with the cross section of the transition that emits these electromagnetic oscillations minus the losses. All right, in this loss coefficient, we take into consideration scattering losses, reabsorption losses, but not the losses that are induced because of this output mirror is not 100% reflective, but it has a very few percentage, not more than 5% transmission in order to have the useful laser light for applications. All right? These losses are have been included within these reflection parameters. So when we make this equal to one, which means at the threshold, because at the threshold, the gains are equal to the losses, which means that our system is not amplified, but also is not degraded, we can solve the previous equation and we can reach the minimum gain that we should build. This is the minimum population inversion that we should build, in above which we have lasing. At this point, at this level, the gain that we have is only appropriate in order to balance the losses and we don't have light. So we need to be just above this population inversion in order to have laser light. The lasing experimentally can be observed with how monochromatic light we achieve. Before lasing, we have mainly spontaneous emission or amplified spontaneous emission, and this can happen in any direction, and it has a wave, a broadening, a land width quite broad that mainly is related with the lifetime of the electrons on the upper energy state. When we have stimulated emission, which means that we are above the threshold, we can see that all this energy that is distributed among all these frequencies that my system supports, suddenly all this energy is concentrated to a few of these frequencies, and we have a stringing, a land width stringing. Our beam becomes more monochromatic than below threshold. And so below threshold, we have no lasing. Above threshold, we have the lasing. And you can see this monochromaticity appears to the signal that we receive from our photodiodes. Also, if we check, this is like from the spectrum point of view, but we can check this also from the output that we received in our photodiodes. And this is the curve of a diode laser. You can see that you pump your system, and this is the point where the loss is equal to the gain. And if you pump it a little bit harder, then you have flash. You can see within the dark room a flashing. Where do you have the lasing? This kind of lasing and this kind of threshold that we should determine when we pack our medium within a pair of high reflectors, mainly also is related with this time duration. And this has to do with the time, with the lifetime of the photons within our cavity. So the longer this time is, all right, the more the photons are trapped within our oscillator, the longer this, the lower the population inversion that we need. Ni is the refractive index of our material, and C is the speed of light. So if we would like to move now from this kind of formula and replace, this is the gain coefficient at threshold, and we know that the gain coefficient is related with the population inversion, we can use this kind of expression. And this kind of expression, using these the Einstein coefficient expressions, we can see that the minimum gain that we need, that is related now in terms on the population inversion, is related with some specific parameters of our system and our material. So we can see that the higher the frequency, the higher the demands regarding pumping. We should pump, we should reach higher population inversion, since the threshold is higher, in order to have a laser. Also, we can see that T2 is the life of the electrons on the excited state. So this, we would like to have this lifetime as long as possible, but because we have a monochromatic light, we would like this also to be as short as possible, because the language, how monochromatic light we have, is reverse analogous of this time. So we would like this time to be long compared to the time that the lower energy level has. And since this is excited one, we would like this lifetime of the lower energy level to be as short as possible in order to have this as long as possible. And also, what else we need? We need to have a cavity where the photon stays within it, which means that we would like the reflections of the mirrors to be close to 100% in order to increase the lifetime of the photons within our system. Eh? Whenever we have an output, it's gain for us, but at the same time, it's loss for our system, and everything is studied according to the system. So we would like this to be long, and this is long, the lower this number. So fundamentally, you should check out this left part. This right part, and you would like to vary parameters that they are related to with the material, like the refractive index, the frequency, the T2, and also with your cavity, which means that your mirrors with TC, you should play around with these parameters in order to make this number as small as possible. We have lasers now that emit light continuously, and these are the CW lasers. My PhD is in CW lasers. Fortunately, these are the real lasers, because CW means that they emit laser light continuously. This means continuous wave lasers, but at the same time, they have the less applications. Mainly, the main applications of CW lasers are as a or spectroscopy. On the other hand, we have pulse laser systems, which means that we emit light stops, emit, stop, emit, and stop. Whenever we have no light emission, this means that we are below the threshold level. Now, what we can see on this kind of figure, we can see the following: that above threshold, and as you increase your lasing output power, always your gain is clamped to the threshold. This means that if an output power, we have an output power from a laser with 3 milliwatts, then the steady state condition dictates that in order to keep this at 3 milliwatts, which means that your output power does not increase, but is not also degraded, then your gain should be clamped to the threshold value. So if you would like to go from the 3 milliwatts to 5 milliwatts, of course you should increase your population inversion, but very fast your population inversion will clamp to the threshold in order to achieve this continuous wave steady state operation. Is it okay with you, Kevin? Do you understand what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Okay. I'm surprised that you can understand me, but it's okay if you say yes, it's yes. The other thing that we should, this is like a small cartoon that depicts what happens as the laser oscillates within these two mirrors. And you can see that we cannot make the mirrors 100%. So the lifetime of the lifetime of the photons within our systems can have a value, cannot be, we cannot have infinite lifetime of these photons within our cavity. And also we can see how spontaneous emission can trigger the stimulate emission and vice versa. So the take up message for you in order to have a stable optical resonator is like our system through the population inversion using the characteristics of the cavity, which means the reflectivity of the mirrors, plus the characteristics of our material, which are related with the lifetime of the electrons and the excited state, and the refractive index of the material, and also the transition probability between the levels that are involved in lasing, which will secure a population inversion more than the threshold, which means that we should secure a ground trip gain after one round trip more than. Only in this case, our beam will oscillate within our system and we will achieve, we will overcome losses and we will have this, we will have lasing only if we are above threshold. And also if we would like to check out, because we have an oscillating, an oscillation means we start from the same point and we return at the same point of the electromagnetic in the cavity, the phase difference that we should include should be ideally 2 pi or otherwise zero. Of course, there are various factors that they can determine this phase difference after after a round trip. And this has to do with the refractive index. Some materials, they demonstrate a refractive index that is related, is a function of the circulated intensity. And this probably can induce changes of the refractive index. Also melting because of the high intensity of the circulating light intensities, probably we have a degradation of our crystal and this generates changes on this kind of refractive index, which means that we change the pathway length of the electromagnetic wave within the our system, and this can induce a different phase difference than 2 pi. And also the reflectors, if they are misaligned, also they introduce different optical pathways, which is related with different induced phase difference. And also this can induce the seizing of our laser system. So, I mean, I said to you before, and you can see in this cartoon within the parentheses, you can see the gain medium, where the gain medium is. This is the, do you know this condition? Have you ever seen? It comes from physics one. We used to say in physics one, if you have a rod that is tightened between two, let's say sticks, you can, and you try to oscillate the rod, you will see oscillations of a specific frequencies and not all the frequencies, since the frequencies that they survive, they are these ones that if you take the integer, this is an integer, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and etc. Only these frequencies that they satisfy this condition, this is in terms of wavelengths, of course, which has to do with this length, the distance between the two mirrors, then all of these frequencies, they will survive within our system. So these frequencies, of course, they are among the frequencies that my laser medium emits, but also not all of them they will survive, but only these ones that they satisfy for this specific length, they satisfy this condition. So the oscillator is not only enhances somehow the length of our gain region, but also induces a filtering, makes our a spectral filtering, makes our laser system more monochromatic than it should be if we have just the gain medium. So all these frequencies, if you place here 1, 2, 3, 4, or whatever, these are the allowed, we used to say that these are the allowed frequencies within our system. So these frequencies are supported by the material, but also they are supported by the cavity. And these are called the, the longitudinal modes, the longitudinal modes of this, of my laser system. So if you see that the laser emits at 635 nanometers, this is one of the longitudinal modes that my system emits. And you can see that all these frequencies, they are separated by a specific spectral distance, which is called free spectrum range. And this free spectrum range is mainly determined by the length of my cavity. And of course, this length in, if it's going to combine with the characteristic of our material, which is the refractive index, then we have also included here the optical path. So the optical path of these modes of these different frequencies define this free spectrum range. So what we can see here on the top, we can see our material, how many frequencies my material can support. All these frequencies, they oscillate within the cavity. So all these frequencies, they have a specific distance between them, but because this is the gain profile of my system, these are the frequencies that my system supports, and they have a distance that is defined by the optical length of my configuration, but only these ones, after 12,000, for example, round trips, only this we will have on the output, only these ones that they have the highest gain. So you can see, finally, as a laser output, we have the survival of this, and this one, and not these ones, modes, these frequencies, since these two have less gain compared to this one, for example, or this one. And so imagine 12,000 times this intensity of this frequency compared to the intensity of this frequency is much higher. So this one, it seems that does not exist. All right. So you can see another picture of the same idea as I mentioned to you. And if I would like to stop here and ask you if you have some questions, is it something that it's hard for you to realize until now?
Just to create your transparent to more understand.
Excuse me?
I have to read again your transparent.
Okay, until now, can you follow me?
Yes, I can follow.
All right.
The filter, yes. All
right, anyhow, I will share with you the video immediately afterwards. Otherwise, I will forget it. So it's not only what is happening within the cavity, but what we will get also is a beam. And if I'm going to ask you, how do you imagine a laser beam? You will tell me a circle, or with the red, or with the blue, or whatever color my laser system emits. So we have, if we take a card and we depict within the card outside of our laser system the laser beam, we will see a distribution of energy on our card. Okay? Wherever we have a light, we have energy. So this energy can have. We have another description regarding our laser system. It's like how this energy at the output is distributed into the space. For example, in a two-dimensional imaging card, and these are called the transverse modes of my laser system. So the transverse modes of a laser system is the energy, the output energy, and how does this output energy is depicted on an imaging card. And these transverse modes, they can consist from many longitudinal modes, all right? So the longitudinal modes, they have to do with the frequencies that my system, my configuration, oscillator, and material can support. On the other hand, the transverse electromagnetic modes, they describe how this optical output is distributed within the space. So the most ideal one is the circle, like a laser beam, like a circle, small laser beam, which is called the TEM00, since we have energy all over a circle. But also we have other configurations that they emit light with a different energy distribution. Here is the TEM00. Here you can see the TEM01. So this is like X and Y. So here you can see that you have a zero on the X axis. Here you have a zero on the Z axis. That's why here we name it 10, since the zero is on the Y axis. Here we have a zero on the X axis and also on the Y one. So we have TEM11, all right? So ideally we would like to have in laser systems like this configuration, this kind of distribution, TEM00, since with one lens, we can handle and we can manipulate all this energy the way that we want. But there are other applications, for example, that they desire this kind of configuration problem. They don't want to pump another laser through along this direction, and they would like to pump only this direction and this direction, or they would like to pump four different points and avoid to pump their intersection. So there are applications that also they desire the higher transverse electromagnetic modes, but as a rule of thumb, think that we desire very strongly the TEM 00. Okay?
Yes.
So now we mentioned before that we would like to have a very stable optical resonator. And the stability has to do with two things, like to have a very, actually, it is related just with one, right? Just one, in order to keep, you know, the story simple. We should, our mirrors, they should be aligned and they should be distanced in such a way that they introduce a phase difference after one round trip of zero or two pi. And if we would like to translate this kind of condition to designed to a corresponding designed parameters, we can say that we have stability, we have a stable laser resonator or resonator when this condition satisfies, with D to be the distance between the two mirrors, and R1 and R2 in this case to be the curvature, how curved are our mirrors. This is the radius of curvature, all right? You can see it over there. So if this is the condition, then we have a stable, the stable cavity. Now, we mentioned that we have a variety of configurations of configurations regarding the oscillators. We can have the plane parallel configuration, we can have the long radius configuration, we can have the confocal configuration, and we can have the hemispherical configuration. The most employed one is this one, the confocal one, because you can see using this confocal one, we can focus our beam around our material. So if our material is on this area, we can say that we can pump our material very hardly, because, and we can pump our material strongly in order to build population inversion, induce spontaneous emission and then lasing, and then achieve this the gain. On the other hand, this has to do with the pumping. The smaller the surface that we pump, the harder the intensity. This is something that you know. Ideally, we would like to pump homogeneously all our medium. We will move to this plane parallel configuration, but there is a high risk over there that a small misalignment of one of the mirrors, then after a few round trips, we will have the oscillation of the light outside of the mirror, which means that we will pump with a lower pumping rate our material, and we will never reach the threshold, and the system will never lace. So we would like to have the confocal one, but we should be with the confocal one. We have to design specifically our medium in order to occupy just this area and not have a big cube, and we have any areas that we don't pack. If we would like to, how can I say, depict and graph this this stability criterion, we have a stable laser cavity on the white regions, and on the gray color regions, we have instabilities. And with this, I think that we can stop at this point. I can give you time for, I think that these kind of transparencies are already uploaded into the Moodle. You can download it from them, or you can listen to my video again and try to answer for the next time. And with this, I think I can stop. We do not have a break. I took you from 5 o'clock until now. From 3 o'clock, so I think it's a good time. Any questions?
Roger, no, I don't have a question.
All right, man. So study, answer the questions for the next time, and okay, I will see you during the evening. but